Welcome to Monash City Church of Christ Online. This morning we're going to worship God through song, share together in communion, and hear God's word preached. Our guest speaker this morning is Sally Minnett from Canterbury Gardens Community Church. Some of you may know Sally through BSF, Bible Study Fellowship, and she'll be preaching on Deuteronomy 6, so we can look forward to that. But why don't we pray, commit our time together to God. Please join me. Father God, we thank you we can gather together wherever we are and worship you. We pray now that you would stir our hearts, remove those distractions and help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Help us to hear from your word, your truth. Have your way with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
To wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, not like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. God is healer, awesome in power, our God. lose heart. Oh my soul, don't give up. There is hope, there is always hope. There is peace in the storm, no, don't forget. Lord, He is Lord of all. There is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty, freedom is in His name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise, there is a Lion roaring, Jesus, the King of glory. So lift your eyes, stand in awe, there is one, only one, where my help comes from. There is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, it's one who is strong and mighty. Freedom is in His name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a Lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. Nations bow, mountains shake, the sound of just one name. Over all, Jesus reigns. I know, I know. Nations bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name. Over all, Jesus reigns. I know, there is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty, freedom is in His name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a Lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. There is a Lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory.
Where my sin and where my shame,
the cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
I really enjoy a good book with a good story, and all the better if you can sit in a relaxing place to read it. Like in the garden, with something to drink and something to nibble on. But when the weather won't let that happen, our imagination has to kick in. I've been reading this book at the moment. It's called The Story, The Greatest Story Ever Told. I'm going to read you a little of the story from where I'm up to at the minute. After he had fed the 5,000, Jesus immediately made the disciples go into a boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water towards Jesus. I'm not sure what came over Peter at that moment, as ships and lakes were part of Peter's everyday life. In his lifetime, he'd probably fallen out of boats, jumped out of boats, been pushed out of boats countless times, and each time he would have experienced the same result. He would sink. So here he is in the middle of a storm, in the middle of the dark, and he's expecting to walk on water. Well, back to the story. Then Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Here's another interesting response from Peter. We know Peter could swim because he swam to Jesus whilst Jesus was cooking breakfast on the beach. But on this occasion, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And then they climbed into the boat and the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him. "Truly, you are the Son of God." When Peter took his eyes off Jesus and looked at the storm, he was in lots of trouble. Jesus knew we would have the same problem if we took our eyes off him and focused on the storms or the virus, etc. So he gave us something here that we can have whenever we meet together to help us keep our focus on him and what he has done for us. So as we take our piece of bread or biscuit or whatever we have for communion this morning, Jesus says, "This is my body given for you. Let's eat it together." As we drink from our cup, we acknowledge that Jesus' death gives us real, true, amazing life. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Lord, sometimes we're as guilty as Peter at following our own plans, not yours. Forgive us for wanting what other people have. Forgive us for not trusting you, for not embracing change and for doubting your goodness. We are sorry for not believing that the changes you bring into our lives are for good and not for harm. Thank you that you are the God who forgives, and we acknowledge your forgiveness and accept that we are your disciples once again, no matter what the future may bring. Help us to embrace the changes that you bring into our lives. Like Peter, we cry out, "Lord, save us," knowing that you are always there to rescue us when we cry out to you. Thank you that you are the God who knows us inside and out, yet you still choose to love us. We offer ourselves afresh to you this morning, and as part of that, we bring our offering electronically or to be delivered in whatever form to be used for your kingdom and to say thank you for all that you have given to us. Amen. This book is actually available, and if you would like to get a copy, you can contact the church office and we'll even post one out to you. But also in the library, we have a study on DVD and a study guide that is a really helpful study. Some of us did it last year, and it is available for loan. And so you can contact us through the church office.
One of the ways we can worship God is through our giving. We have this privilege of investing into God's work in our local community and abroad through our missions family. If you'd like to give, please find instructions on the screen.
Well, good morning, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to come back and speak with you guys. I was really looking forward to seeing you face to face, and perhaps we'll do that another time. But I have been asked to speak from Deuteronomy 6, and I'm telling you this because you have no excuse not to go and get your Bibles. I'm going to pray, and if you don't have your Bible in front of you, why don't you go and grab it now, and let's together commit this time to our God. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to meet, albeit in our own homes, but yet together, around your word, your living word, conscious that your living spirit is in us and speaking to us. And so we ask that we could just set aside all that is going on around us right now, that we could shut that out, and we could spend this next short time with you, listening to what it is that you have to say to us. Father, for those of us who need encouragement, would you send that to us this morning? For those of us who need to be stirred into action, would you also do that this morning? For those of us who are looking for help, for instruction, Father, you have promised this through your Spirit and by your word, and so we ask that you would do this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so you have your Bibles now, don't you? And I want you to turn, please, to Deuteronomy, and it's chapter 6. Deuteronomy is the fifth book in the Bible, the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And it's been called by some a book on the boundary. Because as we come into this book, and we're in chapter 6, we're standing with Moses on the boundary, the very edge of Canaan. Egypt and the wilderness is behind us, and the promised land is ahead, just on the other side of the Jordan. It's a boundary geographically, but it's also a boundary historically. What do I mean by that? This is a momentous moment. This is a moment when, under God's hand, through Moses, Israel has emerged from under the Egyptian Empire to establish a genuine alternative. This is going to be a new kingdom. It's going to have totally different social practices, different ethical values, different politics. Nothing like this has ever happened before. And so here in Deuteronomy, particularly in this chapter, we feel the tension, because what is going to happen next? It's like when your child has just turned 18 and they're starry-eyed about all the things that she can now do legally, all the places she's allowed to go. Or the child who leaves home for the first time to start out on his own. And the tension of the moment as a parent or a grandparent or a friend looking on, you see the excitement of a new start and new opportunities, but is she ready? Will he have the maturity to make the right choices? Is there that inner conviction that will help them to pursue the right goals? Is there a wisdom there to help him or her discern the direction that they will take in the future? And you don't have to be a parent to know what I'm talking about, because each of us has stood at one time or another at a boundary point where we know that the decisions, the choices that are ahead of us that we are going to make will be prove crucial in the direction that our life will take. So how do we equip ourselves for those moments? And how do we equip our children for those moments? How do we plant those faith seeds in the lives of our children? How do we nurture those faith seeds in one another's lives? How do we plant those seeds so that they will grow to maturity? That's sort of the overlying question of Deuteronomy. The question is, when these people cross this border, and remember they're going to go without Moses, when they settle into this land, will they remain loyal to the one true living God, or will they succumb to the pressures of a polytheistic society? You know what that word means. Many gods. Will they live distinctive lives characterized by justice and compassion, or will they sink to the corruption and perversions of Baalism? This new environment that they're going to step into after 40 years of what really has been an insular life in the wilderness is going to appear incredibly enticing and seductive. How will they respond? That's the tension in Deuteronomy, and we see it predominantly in this chapter, chapter 6. So you have your Bibles. Will you have a look with me at the first three verses of this chapter? This is Moses speaking. Remember, they're standing on the boundary. Now this is the commandment, the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God has commanded me to teach you, that you might do them in the land where you are going over to possess it, so that you and your son and your grandson might fear the Lord your God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. Israel, you should listen and be careful to do it, that it may be well with you and that you may multiply greatly, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you in a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, what will Moses say next? Verse 4, and you know this verse well, it's known as the Shema, and Shema is taken from that word listen, where he says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one." This is a huge statement. This is one of the key verses in Deuteronomy. This is one of the key themes in Deuteronomy, the fact that he is one God, living God. There is no other God but our God. So what will Moses say next? Well, it's fascinating that he says, "Therefore, tell the kids." He doesn't say, "Now let's talk about the implications for future government. Let's talk about what this means for the economies of our new nation. Let's talk about how we're going to prepare for inevitable warfare under the weight of this truth." No, he says, "You know what the most important thing is that you and I can do with this? It's to tell the children." Do you get that? And so the rest of this chapter talks about deliberate strategies for passing on the faith and keeping the memory alive. We're not going to read these next verses, but if you know them and if you don't, I encourage you to read them after this service. He talks about speaking about these things daily and naturally, just part of your daily life. He talks about your personal life, suggested by the hand and the forehead, and family life, suggested in verse 9 by the doorposts, and public life, the gates of your house. This is all in verses 6, 7, 8, 9. But it's what Moses says next that I want you and I to look at this morning, and I hope will impact you as we discuss the significance of these verses. Jump with me to verse 20. When your son asks you in time to come, saying, "What do the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments mean which the Lord commanded you?" Then you shall say to your son, "We were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out from Egypt with a mighty hand. Moreover, the Lord showed great and distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household, and he brought us out from there in order to bring us in." He brought us out in order to bring us in. You know, talking to our children and to one another about what we do and don't do as Christians and how we go about obeying God's commands, remembering Jesus said, "If you love me, you will obey my commands," is vital. But we don't stop there. Because when the kids start asking why are we different? Why do we do the things that we do? Why are you teaching these things to us? When the kids start asking why, don't reply with a sermon. Don't reply with another list of do's and don'ts. Don't even reply with a catechism. Answer with a story. Answer with a story. Some of you, I know, are old enough to remember some of the hymns that I love too. The old, old story, it is ever new. I have a story to tell to the nations. I love to tell the story. So this is not a new thought. But I think we forget how important this story is. And you and I are wired for stories. That's how our brains engage. If you tell me a story, I enter into it emotionally, not just intellectually. And the stories that you and I are told in our childhood shape us. And what's the story? What is the story that Moses says, tell this story to your children? Well, over four centuries, the people of Israel had lived in Egypt. Egypt was the dominant world power. Egypt, with its breathtaking architecture, its sophistication, its excellence in arts, its intellectual pursuits, engineering that still blows us away today, there was no one that came close to Egypt. It dominated the landscape, literally, but it dominated politically and it dominated spiritually. And at the center of it all, of Egypt, was Pharaoh, the king, who was worshipped as a god. He was surrounded with so much splendor, by so much awe and mystery and power that it was almost impossible not to believe that he wasn't a god. But you know what? It was all a facade. And in Eugene Peterson's words, he says, "The place was crawling with maggots of abuse and cruelty and superstition and degradation. And at the heart of that place was a man who ruled with an iron fist. And at his mercy were the Israelite slaves." And God? Well, after four centuries of silence, I think Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were almost lost to memory. But we read that God, back in Exodus, heard their prize. Verse 21 again, you shall say to your son, we were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out from Egypt with a mighty hand. You know, we have such short memories that it was only a very short time after the rescue, the redemption, the bringing out from Egypt, that we read that the Israelites said, we remember the fish we ate in Egypt, the cucumber, the melons, the leeks, the onion and the garlic. How often had they forgotten the facts? We were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt. And it took a mighty hand to bring us out. One author writes, when we suffer from amnesia, every form of serious authority for faith is in question, and we live unauthorized lives of faith and practice unauthorized ministries. I'm going to say that again because I want you to take that in. When we suffer from amnesia, when we forget, every form of serious authority for faith is in question, and we live unauthorized lives of faith and practice unauthorized ministries. We must tell the story to prevent amnesia. We must tell the story to prevent amnesia. But there's something even more serious than forgetting that is going on here. There's something more important than amnesia. In The Silver Chair, if you have read it, and if you have not, put it on your list of books I must read in the next 2 weeks. It's part of the Narnia series. And if you haven't read it for a while, go back and read it again. And if you're familiar with it, you know there are two children, Eustace Scrub and Jill Pole, and they have a friend, his Puddle Glum, the Marsh Wiggle. And in the story, they find themselves in the underbelly of Narnia, underground. In an underground world, they've come down into this world where the only sun that is there is the cold light coming from a ball that's being carried on top of a pole. There are no stars, no trees, nothing is green, there's no mountains, no sky, no horizon, no wind, no birds. And here in her domain, the witch queen begins to weave her spell. To convince these children and their friend Puddle Glum that the world above, the world of sunshine and green grass and mountain tops, never existed. And she says to them, there never was any world but mine. And they begin to repeat, there never was any world but yours. She almost succeeds in casting her spell. I won't tell you how she fails. You'll need to read the book to find out. But you know what? We've had a tiny taste of that deception in recent weeks. How easily it is that we fall into this spell of thinking that there is no other world but this. We're coming out of it now. But for a short time, we lived in a world that was totally different to anything that we had experienced before. And somebody wrote about it in this way. This was written about 4 weeks ago. But she wrote, at certain hours in recent days, my own corner of the world has clouded over as well. I felt a chill creep up and squeeze the warmth out of my lungs on Tuesday when I arrived at the grocery store as it opened to find the shelves and fridges picked almost clean of produce, canned vegetables, grains and meat. Such an odd feeling, isn't it? She says this is what happened in her brain. This voice starts to say, there never was any world but mine. This is now reality. And fear seemed to murmur to her, a world crammed with projections and rumors and sobering reports, the conclusions and feelings of powerlessness that followed in their wake left her confused and under its spell. Do you see what I'm saying? The people of Israel, when they were living in Egypt, saw on a daily basis its glory and its power and its dominance and its stability. They heard the words of Pharaoh saying, "There is no other God but me." Surely this world was all there is. No gods but these. No power, says Pharaoh, but mine. No reality but this. And it took God to step in when he heard their cry. And you'll remember what he did. You'll remember the plagues of Egypt. What were those plagues of Egypt? This was not God in competition with the gods of Egypt. There is no competition. This was God exposing the gods of Egypt. And so what does it say here in verse 21? You shall say to your son, "We were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, but God brought us out from Egypt with a mighty hand." And one of the key themes in Deuteronomy is this statement that there is one God, there is no other. It is not God competing with the gods, it's God exposing the gods. Back in Exodus, you read in chapter 8, the magicians tried and they could not. They could not. God exposed their false claims to authority and power. The plagues, one by one, exposed the impotency of the gods. Until finally, we read that the Egyptians lay dead on the seashore. That's the story. It's not just a story of remembrance, but a story of exposing the lies and telling the truth. There are two kingdoms. We live in a world that wants us to believe that there is no other world but this. And when we teach our children the story, we expose the lie, we dismantle the facade, we uncover the truth, and we say there is one God and one lasting kingdom. And to make sure that that story was told year after year, because God knew how easily we forget, he instigated the Passover. And he said, "Year by year, I want you to put into practice this festival and tell your children and tell the story over again." And I can imagine this story being told at times when Israel was in exile or at war or under great suffering. You know, you read the book of Judges, for example, and you just go, wow. Because we know the end of the story with Deuteronomy, don't we? We know the answer to the question. Sadly, the answer is no, they didn't remain faithful. No, they were not a distinctive community. They did not remain holy. But you can imagine as the Passover was kept year after year and the story was told year after year, the children asking, or even the adults, "God brought us out, into what? God brought us out, but into what?" Well, one day, a baby was born in Bethlehem, and some wise men came looking for a king. And when Jesus started his ministry, he began with this announcement in Mark 1:15, "The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." You see, Jesus came to bring in the new kingdom. And the good news, believe in the gospel, the good news is that God's mighty arm would bring us out to bring us in. And the Passover feast that was kept faithfully all these years, Jesus took that and he deliberately transformed it. And he said, "Whenever you eat this bread and whenever you drink this cup, you will do this in remembrance of," not Egypt anymore, "me." But it's the same story. And if you want to see what Jesus taught about kingdom living, go to the Sermon on the Mount. In fact, it's a beautiful parallel. Just it's worth looking at beside Deuteronomy. It picks up some of the themes of Deuteronomy. Jesus starts with the heart and what goes on the inside. Just as in Deuteronomy here we read, "For the first time you must love the Lord your God with all your heart." It starts on the inside before you look at what it looks like on the outside. But you know, in the Sermon on the Mount, and John Stott says that the key verse on the Sermon on the Mount, by the way, is, "Do not be like them." As you go through the Sermon on the Mount, you begin to recognize two kingdoms, not in competition, but that one is exposing the other. Jesus talks about two kinds of righteousness, the real and the false. He talks about two kinds of prayer, the genuine and the empty. He talks about two kinds of treasures and two masters and two ambitions, two gates, the narrow and the wide. The wide, which will take you to destruction, emptiness, empty promises, empty life, empty, there's nothing there to satisfy. Two foundations, the rock and the sand, which offers nothing under your feet. And in each case, Jesus is not offering something better. This is not a case of a good kingdom and a better kingdom, but he's exposing the false against the true. And when you read the Sermon on the Mount, you realize how much he has turned everything upside down. He so rightly said, "My kingdom is not of this world." So what's the end of the story? Well, you and I know the end of the story. You can read about it at the end of your Bible. Revelation 11:15, the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. That's the end of the story. This is the story that you and I must tell our children. This is the story that you and I must continue to tell one another, often, naturally, deliberately, a story that not only combats amnesia, helps us not to forget, but it exposes the lie. And in that way, we equip one another, we equip the next generation, we equip ourselves to make mature, informed decisions, to make wise and right choices, to live those lives of distinction that we are told to live, that as we are growing those seeds of faith, we are doing so knowing the truth. Let's not forget, when your son asks you in time to come, saying, "What do the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments mean which the Lord commanded you?" Then you shall say to your son, "We were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt." That's the truth. "And the Lord brought us out from Egypt with a mighty hand. He showed great and distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household. And he brought us out from there in order to bring us in." Will you pray with me? Father, we recognize how easily we can believe the lies, how easily we can be sucked in to believe that this world is all there is. And Father, when you brought in your kingdom through your Son, you brought not a better kingdom, but a new one. So, Father, help us to understand what this means as we teach our children and our grandchildren, our nephews and our nieces, our Sunday school kids, but more than that, as we give this to one another on a daily conversation. And now, even as we are not able to meet face to face, Lord, how can we encourage one another by sending messages, by writing emails, by making phone calls, telling the story again, the story that exposes the lies and plants us deep in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Thanks for joining us in this morning's worship service. I'll just leave you with the words from Peter and 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. May you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. God bless you and have a great week.
We are often told, God loves you. But what does that really mean? That some impersonal force, galaxies away, may consider you from time to time? Or that you are a single drop in a vast ocean of humanity, and God cares for all of it? There are billions of lives, billions of stories. Can we really believe He has great destinies planned for all of them? Surely the ruler of the universe has more important affairs than to notice the needs of one singular individual. But hear this, nothing could be further from the truth. When God says, I love you, it means that He crafted every detail of your being. Your every feature is His perfect design. His mind perceives your worries and your thoughts. His heart is broken by your pain. You are His child, created in His image. Your value exceeds all the riches of earth. Your worth extends beyond the stars. And though you may be unaware, He's carefully constructing the events of your life to build His kingdom. If you are willing, He can and will achieve wonders through your hands. It is the deepest passion, the most meaningful promise. It is your security, your hope, and your future. It is the truth beyond doubt. God loves you.